My name is Kate Weaver, and I'm an associate professor here at the LBJ School and a colleague of Jamie Galbraith. It's my pleasure to be here to moderate this session. I have to admit, I don't know exactly what's going to be discussed in this panel, but I'm dying to know whether or not this panel is entitled The Control of Finance, period, or The Control of Finance, question mark. So I'm hoping our panelists can answer that question in particular. While Bill Black struggles to arrive at Austin, I think we may actually start with Tom, if you don't mind. I'm going to keep time pretty strictly, that each panelist will get 10 minutes. If they exceed that and I see a 12-minute mark, I will stand up and look very stern until you stop speaking. And likewise with the question and answer period, we want to make sure that everyone gets their voice in the process. So I will cut off questions that dally into long comments and rants to make sure we have sufficient time for discussion. On that note, Tom Ferguson, Institute for New Economic Thinking.
Yeah, well, what Kate actually said to me was, if we talked too long, she was instructed to be like Mussolini. And that reminded, there's no shortage of people in the state of Texas, I think, who would like to do that. That brought me back, the combination of listening to Phil Angelides' fine speech and sort of my task of trying to draw some links there, made me think of the old story about former Governor Shivers here in Texas. When he died, people filed past the casket for 3 days. And the thing that puzzled everybody was just about everybody agreed that most people hated Shivers. And so the question was, why are so many people going past the casket? And the answer was, they all want to make sure he's dead. Now, this, of course, applies in after the financial crisis, right? We'd like to think that, you know, the banks were dead. They're not. They're very much alive. You know, Shivers was dead, but our financial system titans are still very much alive. That was the message from Phil's luncheon talk. I'm hardly going to disagree with it. I want to just drop a couple of things on you. The first one, this is one of my favorite graphs of all time. It comes out of a paper that Paul Jorgensen, who's sitting up there, and I and Ji Chen wrote, where we spent a considerable amount of time actually doing the real percentages of the real amounts of money spent in various elections. That's a much harder task than you might think. And the published stuff you shouldn't believe. I don't want Kate standing up, so that's the limit of my talk. What we do there is we graph Democratic percentage of total money against the Democratic margin in elections, and you can see the results. Now, I actually taught political science. I'm among, in Texas, I was among the people when Jamie was saying, oh, all these people passed through the University of Texas, he was kind enough to say, and remain in the community. I also think of that old line that was somebody's long ago. They said more good people have passed through the University of Texas than any university in the world. That's because of its funny, troubled history there, though I'm not claiming anybody pushed me out, although there were some very sharp exchange, frank and comradely exchanges, as the Albanians used to say, before 1989. Anyway, the thing there is, like, you know, if you got most political scientists would tell you, oh, the relationship between money and individual election results ought to be, you know, in some cases they might be real tight, in other cases real relaxed. What we found is they're basically straight lines. And worse, when we carried this stuff through for every election for which there's data, that since 1980, we find the same pattern, always, Senate, House, whatever. And you might, there's some of you thinking, maybe there's an omitted variable there. I will just ask you to believe, this is after all a 12-minute talk before Kate stands up. If you stick any reasonable instrumental variable there, including some new ones we did, it turns out the coefficients actually rise. In other words, this is not a mistake. This is your election system. Money talks in the accent of Stentor, you know, the herald who spoke in the Iliad, I guess, with the voice of 50 men. Here's my other graph. which comes from a paper Rob Johnson and I wrote, and this is a warning against the belief that campaign finance is your only problem. It's not a view that you're, I understand, Phil, likely to fall prey to. What we did there is graph the very bottom line shows you the sort of, looks like a sort of worm gradually expiring. That's the salary of the top-level federal officials, the Federal Reserve, and the civil service links aren't the same, but they sort of follow that. Then we have two different ways, top 1% and the top one-half of 1%. That top one-half of 1% is clearly what the regulators are regulating. And the point to make here is that from about 1975, 77 on, it was sort of like, what's the case? This tells you that I haven't been in a church in a while, except as a tourist. Is it Ezekiel who was snatched up and taken to heaven in a chariot? At any rate, if you can walk out of your regulatory job to become an instant millionaire, the notion that you are going to seriously regulate, forget it. The person who sort of brought this point to me, where this the inspiration for this graph, came from a talk with a former commissioner of the Commodities Futures Trading Commission. He just said, everybody here is in training. It's sort of like this is the one successful employment agency the federal government actually runs. That's not quite that's not quite true, as you know, all those shuttle diagrams in Congress and the SEC and elsewhere sort of underscore, but you can sort of see where I'm going here. Now, the reason I want to just stress this is, you know, as Phil said, there's not much mystery about why finance is, in fact, still not very controlled, why Stanley Fisher sort of squeezes the Tarullo efforts and other things like that. I mean, there's no point in denying that, as anybody can see, you know, GE Capital got peddled off by GE. There are a few other banks, especially the largest ones, restructuring their portfolios a bit, although, you know, for pure humor, the effort in the Wall Street Journal where they tried to make Carl Icahn the other day, who bought into AIG and some other financial enterprises as claiming that they were doing this to help enforce the Dodd-Frank too big to fail provision. That's, of course, a joke. But, I mean, there are some constraints on finance, but basically you remain out of control. Yes, the concentration of deposits is enormous, but also shadow banking is, I think it's fair to say, just growing like weeds. Shadow banking is in the end, you know, where you borrow short to lend longer, which is virtually a definition of a potential problem there. But what you got people securitizing everything, including, as I'm probably some people here know very well, student debt. But that has really gigantically spread. And as you sort of sort through this stuff, it's pretty interesting just looking at the law. In Dodd-Frank, when you sort of peruse that very carefully, you will see these funny provisions in there that were written at the time and with design to make it possible next time around, for example, for the various federal regulators to even bail out a single institution like a clearinghouse, if it gets into trouble. When you look harder, you see internationally a pretty interesting situation, which is the international regulators are kind of in a race to the bottom, waiving all talk about BIS standards and things, or Basel standards and things like that. You can find that the international regulators in each country are sort of sticking up for their own banks. Each one thinks that there'll be, in the end, more concentration. They think the U.S. shows them the wave of the future. Thus, they are telling, they are talking the language of reform, but in fact, each country is sort of reluctant to do anything. And we're all sitting around waiting for somebody to move. It isn't happening. It's not going to happen. And the thing to sort of understand at all the level is in that the final highest levels of regulation, where you get to that supranational level, this is totally dominated by that thing, that's up there, except that now carried to a world level. That is to say, you know, if you sort through the world and you look at how, I dare say, the Clintons, Tony Blair, more Republicans than you could name, but Tim Geithner and Ben Bernanke too. I mean, Geithner, I think, didn't even wait a week to get out of the Fed before he gave one or two talks for about 200,000. You're dealing here in a situation where rotten at the core is probably the wrong word. The regulatory system is rotten at the top. And everybody is sort of, in some sense, in training. And if you can't break that link between what you're doing in your job and where you will eventually be going to become a millionaire and do it not just in the single country but on a worldwide basis, you have trouble. Now, I'm not trying to tell you everything has a happy ending. I usually used to tell my students, I'm now emeritus at the University of Massachusetts in Boston, if you want a happy ending, see a Disney movie. But then, you know, Tim Burton went to work for Disney, and I lost even that line. So I not have happy Halloween.
You know? That's great, John.
Thanks very much, Tom. And that was under 10 minutes. So now that the wine glass is fully emptied, I wonder if we can refill the bottle somewhat with some optimism. Maybe not. We're going to go on now to, Philippe Legrain.
Well, that's a hard act to follow. In fact, two hard acts to follow. As you all know, the deregulation and globalization of the financial sector led to a huge increase in its size, profitability, and political power in recent decades. And contrary to the claim that this would lead to faster economic growth and a better allocation of capital, the bad lending of dysfunctional and dangerously undercapitalized banks inflated the biggest and broadest a property and financial bubble of all time. Abetted by the complacency and sometimes the complicity of central bankers, regulators, supervisors, and politicians. And then the bubbles burst, banks went bust, and an exceptional opportunity to curb the power of the financial sector was missed. Because the ordinary restructuring of banks and, when necessary, their closure would not just have been just, it wouldn't just have limited future risk-taking and restored credit to sound businesses faster. It would have broken banks' political power and rescued some of the integrity of the political system. Now, Phil Angelides spoke very eloquently about the situation here in the United States, and I think I have bad news for you. It's even worse in the Eurozone. In the United States, you've seen that at least the FDIC sold or closed down 465 US banks, including Washington Mutual, your biggest savings bank, between 2008 and 2012. But in the Eurozone, the approach has been that every bank must be saved, with governments stepping in to bail them out, and with creditors almost always made whole. What's worse is that it's not just domestic governments accountable to local voters that have bailed out Eurozone banks. You've seen European taxpayers, Finns, Italians, and Slovaks, as well as French and Germans, being forced to bail out French and German banks that should have suffered losses on their loans to an insolvent Greece. Or you see the further loans that European taxpayers were forced to make to Ireland, Portugal, and Spain, primarily bailing out local banks that would otherwise have defaulted on their borrowing from German and French banks. And as a result of these bailouts, basically the bad lending of private banks became obligations between governments. Now, why did all this happen? I mean, the underlying problem is, simply put, is that every European government is captured by domestic banks. big banks like Germany's Deutsche Bank and France's BNP Paribas are viewed as national champions. Smaller banks like Germany's part state-owned lenders, the Landesbanks, or indeed the Spanish Cajas, savings and loans banks, function basically as political piggy banks. And then banks are also a source of lucrative future employment for policymakers of all stripes. To give just two examples, the disgraced former finance minister of Spain and also a former managing director of the IMF, Rodrigo Rato, who is a conservative, pocketed millions from his chairmanship of bankrupt Bankia in Spain. On the left, you see a former German social democratic politician, former head of the European Bank of Reconstruction and Development, Thomas Miro, who chairs HSH Nordbank, which is also basically bankrupt and still going. And then you see that the banking sector also lobbies assiduously in Brussels. I experienced it firsthand. They spent 120 million euros a year, by one calculation, to try to influence the regulations which are proposed by the European Commission and then enacted by the Council of Ministers representing governments and indeed the European Parliament. And then, last but not least, because the because the Eurozone financial sector is so dominated by banks, with capital markets playing a much smaller role than here in the United States, you have banks that basically dwarf the size of the economy. They are, the banking system in total is many times bigger than GDP, so much, much bigger than here in the United States, where they're roughly 90% of GDP in total. And so those banks are able to persuade even honest policymakers, or to put it differently, they're able to blackmail even honest policymakers into believing that basically they're indispensable to the health of the economy and that they're too big to fail. And then last but not least, you have this incestuous connection because banks tend to be big buyers of government bonds. And that means that governments rely on them to finance their deficits. At the same time, those governments backstop the banks. And as we found out in the Eurozone crisis, that incestuous relationship is also a vulnerability because you had weak banks and weak sovereigns dragging each other down and dragging the economy down with them. But the thing is, while each Eurozone government is captured by its banks, some Eurozone governments are more powerful than others. So banks in Germany have three big advantages. They're backstopped by the most creditworthy sovereign in the Eurozone, which benefits from safe haven flows in a crisis. So even though they were right at the heart of the crisis, in general, they've benefited from much better liquidity conditions than banks elsewhere. Second, as I've discussed, they don't just enjoy the backing of German taxpayers. When push comes to shove, they enjoy the backing of all European taxpayers, as Irish and Spanish people found out at their cost. And last but not least, they have the ear of the German government, which means they can use that sway in order to carve out opt-outs from European legislation that might otherwise constrain them. That's basically the situation. Now, on the surface, a lot has changed since the crisis. You've seen a whole host of new regulations imposed, not least CRD4, which basically transposes Basel III. And we've seen also the launch of the Eurozone's banking union, which is meant to break that link between banks and sovereigns that I've spoken about. But while there's been a lot of change on the surface, that underlying political economy basically hasn't changed. So let me just tell you a bit more about why the banking union is not really what it seems. It was launched back in June 2012, when we were in the midst of the panic that threatened to destroy the Eurozone, when Spanish banks were on the verge of going bust and dragging down the Spanish state, as indeed Irish banks did the Irish state. And the idea behind the Eurozone Banking Union was to break the link between weak banks and cash-strapped sovereigns, and to shift a responsibility for supervising and resolving banks away from national authorities which were captured, to ostensibly independent Eurozone-wide authorities, which could, in theory, better supervise those banks and ensure that creditors were bailed in the event that banks needed resolving. That was June 2012. A month later, the ECB steps in to quell the panic. And while that saved the euro, that took the pressure off policymakers. And you see that after that, the German government acted very quickly to basically eviscerate the contents of the banking union. And basically, all that's left is a shell to keep up appearances. Worse than that, you see that the supervision of banks was handed over not to an independent authority, but to the European Central Bank, which throughout the crisis has acted in the interests of the financial sector in core countries like France and Germany. And you can see this very clearly. Last year, they did an assessment of the strength of Eurozone's banks' balance sheet. And this was a complete farce. You see that they singled out a few banks in less powerful countries to make it look credible, and they swept under the carpet big problems, not least in German banks, some of whose assets weren't even part of the assessment. And overall, they said, well, basically, Eurozone banks are sound, they don't need to raise much additional capital, and French and German banks got a clean bill of health entirely. On top of the fact that you don't actually have an independent supervisor, you have a banking union that is full of holes. The single supervisory mechanism only applies to the 130 or so biggest banks, which again means that the smaller banks that dominate the German financial system, notably the Sparkassen, which are savings and loans, which together have a 1 trillion euro balance sheet, are completely excluded from it. And they still remain basically in the hands of Germany's pliable financial supervisor. Last but not least, and this is really crucial, is that the single resolution mechanism, which is meant to ensure that when banks get into trouble, they will get shut down and that the cost will fall on creditors, not on taxpayers, is a sham, because national governments retain a veto over whether a bank is closed down. And you have a mechanism which is deliberately complex to the extent of being unworkable. So basically, it's inconceivable you're ever going to wind down a bank in that way. And if you leave the decision in the hands of national governments, which are captured by the banking system, you basically mean that the only way in which creditors are ever going to have to pay is if a government runs out of funds. That's not going to happen to France or Germany. It happened to Cyprus. So the big where we're left then is that we're going to carry on in the Eurozone struggling on with this zombie banking system instead of coming to a fair and decisive resolution of the crisis. And even more depressingly is that so long as governments remain captured by these outsized and risky banks, you can bet that in future crises, taxpayers would end up picking up the tab again. Thank you.
Yeah, it should be. Thank you, Philippe. Not the optimism we were hoping for, but it's a beautifully eloquent explanation of the problem with banks in Europe. So thanks very much for that analysis. So next we're going to go with Phil Angelides, and you're going to speak in your chair, correct? Yes. I assume most of you are at the lunch. Good. Well, then I'll give you a personal speech later. To spare most of you,
I thought what I'd do is just make a couple of comments and reserve the time for question and answer, and hopefully Bill's flight gets in and he can join us because he's always terrific. By the way, great presentations. I learned a lot. Those are terrific. Just a couple of add-on comments to what we talked about at lunch. I actually want to pick up on something Professor Ferguson, Dr. Ferguson, Tom.
That's fine.
Okay. Talked about Ness, the regulated versus the regulators. I did want to say one of the things that really struck me during the FCIC's investigation was the extent to which so many people at the regulators were there two, three, 4 years and then out. It was really striking, not just, you know, because we interviewed a lot of folks, well, I said 700 people, and we ended up interviewing a lot of people who had been regulators who had, you know, morphed over to the financial institutions, and there seemed to be a standard pattern. They would go there 2, 3, 4 years, and then because the compensation differences, they'd be, you know, they'd move on. So the one thing, I talked to, not to name drop, but I actually had a pretty good conversation with Ben Bernanke about this very subject. I really do think, you know, this is kind of wonky, it doesn't stand out, but one of the fundamental problems, and it's on Tom's chart, is if you're going to have a functioning, strong regulatory mechanism, you got to have some capability and smarts there. Now, there are a lot of people, by the way, we did come across who, notwithstanding all the compensation incentives otherwise, had built careers at regulators. Really strong people, had a good sense of public service. This is what they wanted to do. But there's no question that the compensation gap between regulators and the industry is so enormous that unless, you know, something is done in a very proactive way to draw and keep people of talent on the regulatory side, you're going to see an enormous mismatch in a couple ways. The inability for regulators to effectively take on regulated banks. But the other thing is, and it's one of the things, if you read the FCIC report, that's quite evident, is in almost every instance of a major bank collapse, the regulators didn't see it till it happened. So there wasn't a lot of, you know, there just wasn't the kind of in-house capacity and smarts about the industry. And I do think one of the biggest kind of public policy things that needs to happen if people are serious about regulation is a real focus on the quality of the people there, the incentives to keep them there, the pay structures. I think it also has a lot to do with why, you know, we all get frustrated because time after time we see where there's evident wrongdoing by a financial institution, but the regulatory agencies decide not to bring a case. And they decide not to bring a case because it's like, you know, like one guy with a bow and arrow against an outfit of 1,000 that have the most sophisticated weapons on Earth. It's an enormous mismatch. And until we kind of get rid of that mismatch, I don't think you're going to have very effective kind of supervision as well as going after wrongdoing in financial institutions. So we ought to keep that on the screen. The second thing I wanted to just comment on briefly, I was going to say, you said rotten at the top, and I was going to say hollowed out in the core. And of course, every year now, if you watch the Congress, every year, notwithstanding the fact that the SEC generates more in fines than its budget, the Republican Congress consistently tries to cut its budget, even though it's not as though it's a consumer of any general funds. Second thing, I just wanted to put a little emphasis on, which is the scale of the banks. And I didn't come to the FCIC believing that the biggest banks ought to be broken up. And frankly, it was after some reflection that I came to that conclusion. And I came to that conclusion because it was evident that there was this regulatory mismatch, particularly acute with the biggest of institutions with the most resources. It's become evident since the crisis with incidents like the London Whale, or a number of other instances where institutions were engaged in wrongdoing. Either the CEO didn't know about it or should have known about it, that these institutions were clearly, you know, too big to manage. One of the things I recall during our hearings was that we were questioning Chuck Prince about their CDO holdings. And this is where they had racked up about $55 billion in losses. And his comment was that in our institution, a $50 billion position would not have gotten my attention. I'm thinking, that's pretty striking for a CEO. Now it's a $2 trillion institution when you count off bound, but for a CEO to say a $50 billion position would not have gotten my attention is really quite striking. It's in the land of la-la. But I think that, and too big to fail, notwithstanding the living wills, the resolution mechanisms, it's inconceivable that if one of these mega banks is about to crash, that we won't find a way to prop them up. And the final thing I'd say is this this notion of being too big for democracy, it really, the amount of resources they spend, if you look at almost every rule that's been promulgated, what happens is there's a fierce rearguard action every time on every front. First of all, there was in Congress. Secondly, it goes over, so much for my short comments, right? I'm getting the time warning. I'm going to tell a quick story here, though. But, you know, the battle then goes to the regulatory agency. And then after the regulatory agency, almost inevitably, the rule goes to court. And, you know, the amount of resources deployed by the industry and the scale of the operations dwarf the ability, in a sense, to hold that tiger. I want to tell you just a couple quick stories, though, because this kind of did it all for me on reflection. During the course of the commission, I focused very hard on not trying to ever talk about the inside baseball of the commission, because I thought it would be distracting from the real work that was in front of us, which was to tell the American people about what happened. It was really only recently that I really began reflecting on all kinds of things that happened during the year that I realized I should have given voice to earlier, because they were relevant to the story. And I'm going to tell you just a couple of stories, and know I got probably 10 to 20 more like this. We're getting ready for our hearings on Citigroup. And one of the things that, you know, we had a year and a half to do our investigation. So the rule to the staff was that when we're going to do a hearing, witnesses have to appear when we need them, on the day we need them, in the order we need them. We really didn't have the luxury of negotiating with a lot of rich and influential people around their vacations or their hair appointments. You know, the rule was you're going to appear on the day we need you to appear. But, you know, if there was some compelling reason, a death in the family, the marriage of a daughter, let's hear it. Short of that, nothing. Long the short of it, Citigroup, represented by Brad Karp, who is the chairman of Paul Weiss, the large New York law firm, they were very contentious with us about who would appear when. Finally, you know, the staff came to me and I said, that's it, just tell them, that's it. Chuck Prince, Bob Rubin, they're going to appear on this day, end of discussion. I get a call at about 11 o'clock that evening from our general counsel, someone I had known for a long time, a senior partner at a major American law firm that I'd convinced to take a leave to come and work for the commission for a year and a half. And he says, Phil, I need to talk to you. Is there something you haven't told me? And I said, like what? He said, well, remember, I'd been treasurer of the state of California, therefore I was on the board of our two pension funds. He said, Brad Karp, who represents Citigroup, when I told him this was it, exploded with anger. He said, everyone knows your guy's dirty and he's coming down. He's under investigation by the SEC. He's under investigation by the California Attorney General. He's hired a lawyer. He's been subpoenaed. He's subject to an internal investigation at CalPERS, CalSTRS. I stopped for a minute and I told my general counsel, false, 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 completely false, no veracity to any of it. And he said, okay. So I figure some guy blowing off steam, passing around bound rumor. So what happens? 2 days later, two reporters from the New York Times, Eric Dash and Sewell Chan, on very good authority, credible sources, have a story. And the story is, guess what? I'm under investigation by the SEC. I'm under investigation by the Attorney General. I've been subpoenaed. I've hired a lawyer. I'm part of internal investigations. And for 6 days or 7 days, they chase the story. They come to the conclusion there's no story. I figure, okay, that's the end of that. What happens next? Wall Street Journal calls. They've got credible sources. I'm under investigation. It finally rolls from the Wall Street Journal, who comes to the conclusion there's no story, to Bloomberg. And I will tell you, it happened repeatedly during the year. And, you know, I could give you many instances of this. The only reason I tell it, though, is it occurred to me after a time that if this is what they did to me, the duly appointed chairman of the commission investigating the collapse that affected our country, this is just the way they operate. It wasn't isolated. It was a modus operandi. And I really do believe that the amount of their power and their hubris is very damaging to our democracy. Someday I'll write my book and I'll tell more stories.
Quick change of plans to give Bill Black more time to get here. We're going to have Olivier Giovannoni come and speak on this panel. And by the way, you have a task in front of you, because we know so far that things are rotten at the top. We have a zombie banking system that's hollowed out of the core with a brain drain from the regulatory system and industry. So you have to keep up with the Walking Dead theme.
So my name is Olivier Giovannoni. I'm an assistant professor at Bard College, north of New York. I am not Bill Black, I'm sorry. I'm going to try to fill in those shoes. Not necessarily easy. I have some PowerPoint that is apparently, as I understand it, coming up. I'm going to try to keep up with the tradition of this session, which is boom, doom, and gloom, if I understand correctly. The title of my presentation is The Folly of Austerity. I'm an economist. We have various strands here, and I think I'm going to complement this panel in that way, that is to bring some economics perspective onto those debates. Originally, I was in the next session, so excuse if I do not follow the tradition for this session, which is finance, but what I want to talk about is austerity. So what I found interesting, I believe, in this phenomenon of austerity is that, I'm teaching undergrad students. And when I teach undergrad students, I tell them that those austerity policies are very destructive. They can be very, very adjustment. Those adjustment policies are extremely destructive. And one should try to find ways to better solve the problems of any given country by ways that are different from austerity in the first place. But of course, Europe and various other countries have engaged into those policies of austerity, and there's not much that can be done. What I was saying is that when I teach those students, I try to teach them, to try to avoid any possible, who knows, maybe one of my students is going to end up in one of those positions, important policymaker decisions. And it's important that they understand that austerity should be a very, very, very last resort, if anything at all. I don't personally believe that austerity can work, and I don't think, this is one of the crucial points of my presentation, I don't think that there is much solid ground in austerity in terms of economics. Now, let me start with the following chart. This is the evolution of a comparison of the evolution of the unemployment rate for both the United States and the Eurozone. The Eurozone is defined here as 19 countries. And what we can see, which I think is very interesting, is that the blue line represents unemployment rate in the Eurozone. And it has always been vastly larger than that in the United States. The only time when there was a point where those two unemployment rates were common to both the United States and the Eurozone was around 2009. And I remember at the time the Europeans were all excited and they were saying, oh, look, our model is working better. You Americans have crashed your economy and your unemployment rate is raising through the roof. But as we can see, post this time period of excitement, there was actually a large rise in unemployment in the Eurozone, whereas clearly we have a different model in the United States, where the unemployment rate has kept going down. So clearly there's a divergence in the past 2 or 3 years. This little vertical line that I put here on the graph, this is actually 2011. This is the time when this is a little bit of a hat tip to Jamie here, who organized a conference with the Center of European Studies. This was the time of the first Eurozone conference, and you can see that there is quite a lot of foresight here, because this is exactly either Jamie caused or more probably Jamie was very well knowledgeable and knew that there was something that was going on here in Europe and that there would be a turnaround like this. Now, moving on to the next slide, if you want to understand what is going on in the Eurozone, this is a time chart of a time pattern of the GDP in Europe. What we can see is that we have this bottom line. This is the red line. This is GDP since 2008 all the way until 2015, the second quarter. What we have is that there is a dramatic fall the red line is investment, and the only things that are remaining stable are consumption. So no growth in consumption in real terms, and even a decrease of this thick blue line, which is GDP. If you're wondering what government spending is doing, it is not represented on the chart, unfortunately, but it is somewhere in the middle here. What is interesting also on this chart, the time pattern of GDP, to see the experience of the European Union here, this is that there is a revival of international trade, and mostly of exports, and not so much of imports. Really, those light blue and pink curves were actually going up right after the financial crisis of 2008. So there is a revival of international trade. We know the reasons for that. But what is interesting is that those two, exports and imports, actually start to diverge, and with clearly exports growing faster than imports, starting in the time of 2010 or 2011. That is the times when austerity was starting to be strongly implemented in the Eurozone. Now, my outline. those are the European promises. Let's never do any bailout. No bailout. Or if we do one, let's not do a second one. Let's not do a third one. Let's protect and cherish our central bank independence. And please let not the central bank interfere in the affairs of the politics. And we know how this turned out. The promise also in Europe, as I understand it, I should have said that at the beginning, that I am French, so this is my personal view, but I have some stake in the game. As I understand it, is that the euro should be very strong and interest rates should be very high, or at least comparatively strong and comparatively high. Do we have high interest rates in the eurozone? The answer is no. Do we have a strong euro? Well, in the past 6 months to a year, there's been a depreciation of about 30%. Keeping inflation in check at 2%, that also didn't work out so well for Europe. Inflation is much lower. I had a chart for this, but I had to cut through to cut it from the presentation. Inflation is certainly not at the level where it's supposed to be. Finally, we have the issues of human rights and solidarity, inequality, which are topics that Europe quite often prides itself with being at the forefront of, and well, facing humanitarian crises, or facing the refugee crises, facing the solidarity with different people from Europe or with Southern Europe, we've seen that there are fractures in this model of solidarity and equality, and deep fractures. Here's my outline now. As I understand it, this is a little bit of a joke, the beginning. Here's the European experience, excuse me. Something happens, then I don't know, but the answer is always austerity. For those of you who like South Park humor, they will understand the reference. But pretty much what I want to talk about is really about the economics of austerity. I don't want to be too technical here because I don't think this is really the place for that, but I do want to make the point, and the point is that it's not a very strong case that can be made for austerity, and certainly not to the extent of austerity has been put in place in the case of Greece, for instance. There's not much support for that in classic textbooks of economics, at least the way that our textbooks are made here in the US. Why do I say this? Well, I say this because if you talk about the aggregate supply, aggregate demand diagram, that is, free markets suggest naturally, well, why would there be austerity? Why should we impose austerity if free markets self-correct in the first place? If you look at models that are a little bit more advanced, something that you would learn usually in your second year, in your intermediate macro here in the US, models such as ISLM, then you can say that, well, you have the model of ISLM. I believe that for the people who are most economists here, would have no problem understanding this. This is pretty much the same framework that then aggregate supply and aggregate demand, except that we can actually speed up the recovery. We can promote economic policies to put in place in order to speed up the recovery. But again, I don't see much basis on this for austerity, except in the case where maybe you are past potential output. So if you are past potential output, such as on this figure here, then maybe you would need, then inflation would kick in, and maybe at that time you need to slow down the economy, perhaps with austerity policies, okay? But clearly this is not the case of Europe, this is not the case of Greece, this is not the case of Spain or Portugal. We are not above potential output. There is no inflationary threats going on here. And therefore, there's no really an incentive for those austerity policies. What we do know, however, is that is what I call the three-sector balances, which is an identity. Not a lot of economics relies on identities. It is something that is always true. This is simply saying, for the least economist of you, this is simply saying that when we have austerity, this generates an impoverishment of the private sector. That is, the citizens will actually directly suffer from austerity policies. Austerity consists in providing less government spending and more taxes, and if that is the case, this is a direct impoverishment of the population. So we know this. We know that austerity is not in ASAD or ISLM, but we know also that, and this is an important point, I believe, we know that in order to stabilize an economy, you can resort to the classic ideas of the multiplier and the accelerator, that is the idea that some government spending will actually spur the economy and will grow the economy. And we'll go back to this point a little bit. Let me skip this because I think I'm being a little bit too long here. On one point, another additional point that I want to make is this dreaded D over Y, that is the ratio of debt to GDP. Let me make a simple point here. The point is the following. If you really are concerned and if you really want to decrease the debt to GDP ratio, well, there's two ways to reduce a ratio. The first one is to reduce the numerator, that is to reduce the debt, or the other way to go about it is to actually increase the denominator, that is to generate economic growth. Pretty much those two strategies, as I wanted to compare the American model to the European model, those two strategies have been put in such a way that the European plan is really to cut, and reduce the debt, whereas the U.S. plan has been sort of a benign neglect here and trying to grow the economy more than anything else. I see some flashing sign that I have to stop, so let me just jump to my last point that I wanted to make. And here it is. I believe that there's that basic macroeconomics, the way that it is being taught in the United States, but also throughout the world, is relatively solid. It has proved, this is a point that has been made by Paul Krugman, for instance, among other people, Joe Stiglitz, etc. In those basic macroeconomic framework, I don't see much case to be made for austerity in a depressed economy. And finally, austerity has a disastrous and political and ideological is a disastrous political and ideological choice. If there is no place for austerity in the economics, or not very much of a place for austerity in economics for a depressed economy, then we must admit that austerity is a choice. And if austerity is a choice, then we have to ask, well, who puts in place those policies and for what reasons and benefiting whom? Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you very much, Olivier. So if I could just round out and beat this metaphor, austerity is dead, yet it keeps coming back.
Yes, it's a zombie.
It is a zombie. Okay, we'll now open it up to questions from the audience. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. As Basel was mentioned, but I think too quickly, there is not only a danger from the regulating, influencing the regulators, but also from the regulators doing regulations that are not, you know, very clever. If you look at Basel, Basel I caused also, or was one factor in the Asian crisis, because they gave a huge preference in the capital weights to short-term lending, which then in Asia practically backfired. Then in Basel II, you allowed banks to have their own calculation of how risky their investments are, meaning Lehman Brothers calculating how good or how safe their investment is. Fortunately, Basel II was not really put into practice fully, because even Alan Greenspan had second thoughts and qualms about it at the end, I understand. Regulators, another example would be Greece, where Basel II at least would have required a higher than zero weight for Greece. But then in came the European Union and outdid, so to say, this requirement by bringing down the capital weight for Greece to zero again with a directive. And so I think not only the regulated, but also the regulators are a bit of a danger to the stability of capital markets, and we should also stress this.
I don't know, maybe each one of the panelists could answer what is your position with respect to Glass-Steagall, the statement of Glass-Steagall, and what is your position with respect to the Tobin tax?
The Tobin tax.
On speculative financial movements.
Sure, I understand that.
Speculative tax, you know, like a transactions tax.
Oh, yeah.
Transactions tax, right?
Yeah. Okay. Somebody's got to talk. Okay.
I have a question for Mr. Angelides. Would the need for regulation be diminished if the Fed made it clear that let more banks like Lehman Brothers fold?
Okay, I was going to go last because I wanted the benefit of. So, I don't think that would be a credible threat. I don't think people in the industry believe it's going to happen. Lehman was the outlier. You know, if you look back, look at the FCIC report, we have kind of the whole history of quote unquote bank bailouts, and you know that we ended up bailing out institutions of significantly smaller size than Bear Stearns or the other institutions bailed out. So I don't know that people would see that as a credible, enforceable kind of market dynamic. I mean, arguably it would, but if you allow them to become so big, they still have systemic consequences, and now you're basing the stability of your financial system on the self-preservation instincts of a large institution. So as to Glass-Steagall, I've thought many times, you know, this is kind of like the breakup of Standard Oil. There's many ways you could do it. I think it's the sheer scale of these institutions and their concentration of both political power and financial assets, and that the scale which makes them quote unquote too big to fail that is most damaging. So I don't know whether it's, you know, highly punitive capital standards above a certain level. You know, right now there are greater capital standards to get bigger, whether it's highly punitive capital standards, whether it's literally just capping the asset size of the banks, whether it's stripping off certain activities as the way to kind of achieve better stability, diversity within the financial industry. But, you know, something's got to happen in that regard. A couple of thoughts. Number one is, and I was saying to someone after lunch, which is that through all the acquisitions and mergers, actually the kind of we've suffered at the regional and community bank level, and regional banks have been very important to deploying capital for economic development, because in the end their marketplace is that region more than it is kind of global speculative markets. So, you know, I'm for a construct that has more robust regional banks. And you know, when people say, well, we need the mega banks, most big loans are participated out in any event. I think the only other comment I'd have is that I just think that federally insured depository institutions should not be in the high risk business. They just shouldn't. Those, whether, you know, it's not quite Glass-Steagall, but you know, a very strong Volcker rule where proprietary trading, high-risk activities are segregated from depository institutions? Yeah, because it's an enormous public subsidy, and the subsidy ain't supposed to be for those kinds of activities.
Okay, on the Glass-Steagall thing, it seems to me that this business is much confused. I mean, exactly as Phil said, yeah, the usual link for justifying some Glass-Steagall deal is the use of insured deposits. But, you know, rethink again, though, whether that really makes sense. The issue is this. It's, okay, so an institution doesn't use insured deposits. If it gets big and goes down and takes like a quarter of the economy with it, and you get what you got after 2008, where you spend years you have a financial crisis, and so you get the sort of Richard Coote type balance sheet recession as a result, where everybody just gets skittish from investing. You spend years after this running well below full employment, and it's like you don't want that to happen. Somebody can improve everybody's welfare with some sensible policy moves. This doesn't have anything to do with insured deposits. It has everything to do with what might be called the smoking in bed problem applied to financial, which is that you can burn down the whole town. And if you can, then you got a case not only for a fire department, but maybe for some rules about smoking in bed. And so it's like if you get that way, what you clearly need is a way to get bankers out of the bank. My slogan on this has been, don't save bankers, even if you have to save banks. I mean, it's like what should have happened, you know, after 2008 seems to me pretty obvious. It's what happened in Sweden and Norway in the 90s, where you essentially get rid of these folks who did this, take all the assets over maybe into a bad bank, take a while to sell them off, otherwise you'll be cratering everything, and then, you know, take equity in public can have equity in the banks and they can eventually get repaid that way. That's, of course, not what happened, as you all know, and you know why. But, you know, that's just Glass-Steagall. Thing. In general, the view that you somehow get better by relying on folks to make the right choices, there, you know, I'm willing to listen to that if it's, what kind of beer do you want to buy tonight or something like that. I'm not persuaded that you can't afford very many mistakes. I mean, in particular, the argument, I heard this stuff all the time about how, well, if you went back to partnerships in Wall Street, that since they were all in, the partners, that would cure the problem too. You know, anybody who knows the history of the United States in the 1920s, where virtually nobody was incorporated on Wall Street, and they all happily overbanked, overlent, over everything. I mean, this is sort of nuts. And I would think a 10-second course in economic history would tell you that most of the stuff that's peddled by academics, but also by journalists, who I would, underscoring your point, none of the bank systems, very few of that's too strong. All right, few of the bank schemes to protect themselves in public policy work without the willing cooperation of journalists at the leading American papers and other media outlets, the electronic outlets too. There's no conceivable way, for example, that the folks who had, you know, as they go serial from the New York Times to the Wall Street Journal, the other, that folks didn't already know there was a serious problem with the story.
So speaking of journalists, Philippe, do you want to weigh in?
I'm not a journalist, but, well, I think we've got a whole host of challenges. One is to try and limit the risk-taking of banks with all the harmful consequences it has on the economy, both during the boom phase and during the bust phase. Second of all, in ensuring that when banks make mistakes, they have big enough buffers so that, in most cases, so they don't go bust with wider consequences. And thirdly, that when they do go bust, that you have a means of shutting them down in a way that not only is technically possible, but actually politically feasible. And it's that last step which I think is hardest, because you can think, in terms of the first, limiting risk-taking, you can think of a whole host of reforms that can attempt to do that. In terms of making banks safer, I think the case for much higher capital requirements is unarguable. But in terms of how do you reduce the political power of the banks such that any resolution mechanism that you create is actually ever going to be used, that really is huge, because you have banks which are huge in terms of size, they're very complex, you have massive conflicts of interest, you have huge political and financial power, plus all the problems I spoke about in the Eurozone, and I'm not sure I see a solution to that, except by going through another crisis and behaving differently when they're on their knees, and to say, well, this time we're not going to save you. Because I think now their power is such, now that they're back on their feet, that I don't see reforms like that being feasible.
I mean, the disadvantage when you speak last is that all the smart things have been said. but the so on Glass-Steagall, I cannot improve very much on this. However, I think part of the question was also on the Tobin tax, and I don't think it has been fully addressed here. I personally, I mean, one of the questions was whether do you support this or that. Regarding the Tobin tax, I personally support it, but part of a general overall overhauling of taxation, and taxation in particular of the capital gains. Whether it is under the form of a Tobin tax or whether it takes the form of some progressive taxation on capital gains or raising taxes on capital gains on unearned income as opposed to labor income, yes, this is the kind of stuff that I would support. But of course, we know from the previous panelists also that the likelihood of those particular policies being put in place in the case of the United States is, appears to be slim. To say the least, we have political capture, and well, sometimes what is desirable is not necessarily feasible.
Thanks very much. We have time for another round of questions. Jamie?
Hello. I guess first I want to sort of make a comment about high salaries, so they don't. People don't. Regulators don't go to the private sector when we're talking about private sector bankers sort of blowing up the system. So I don't know if the smartest people are sort of running the system. But my question is, what is the alternative? I know at lunch Phil was talking about sort of cutting speculation from the investment, but I sort of think. All investments are speculation. We have a limited amount of resources. When you're building a bridge, hopefully it's a good bridge that people use, not a, bridge to nowhere in Alaska. Or, with a real estate development, who are the people, deciding to allocate the resources? If not the speculators, then who?
Thank you. Over here.
So Olivier basically mentioned that it is one of the promises of the European Union was that ECB should not interfere in any political actions or anything. But from the previous panels, we understood that actually it is in the mandate of ECB to have some political say when ECB's objectives are involved. So how do you comment on this? Okay.
Great. Do we have a question over here?
So just one of the things that I find really striking about dealing with a lot of with regulators and government officials is how many of them simply don't believe that it's their job to interfere with what they think of as private actors. And it seems like you are saying in some sense that that we have government via banks. Banks are controlling a lot of our resource allocation and political power. How do you, so it's not just a financing problem, it's not just inequality of wealth vis-a-vis regulators and the private sector. There's actually an ideological problem as well. To what extent do you, that's more of a statement than a question, but to what extent is that, do you find that that's accurate, or is this all really driven by the money?
I think we're going to fit in one more question. Are you okay handling four?
There's been a lot of questions on finance, so perhaps I can just raise one on the austerity presentation from Olivier. I mean, I think at the very high level of abstraction you took, that's sort of right, the way you presented it. I mean, one person needs to just simply think about what austerity is and what it's not. I mean, I think it was a plaidoyer against pro-cyclical, contractionary fiscal policy, right, to be slightly technical about it. Now, that's what he meant, because I mean the three sector equation you put up, you sort of imply that every time there's a restrictive fiscal policy, the private sector loses out, right? But I don't imagine that's what you really mean, or it's certainly not the way I see it. I mean, you can run contractionary fiscal policy, but you should just be doing it in a counter-cyclical way, i.e. During boom times. So perhaps you could state your view on that. And a second point, which I think is more important, is one really has to distinguish between a country like the U.S. with its own central bank and its own treasury, and what it can do in a crisis, and what a eurozone country like Spain or Greece could do in the crisis. Right? I mean, to be a bit provocative, when the crisis hit, and at this moment in time, Greece had been running massive current account deficits, had massive fiscal deficits. I mean, one could draw the implication from your presentation that you would then advocate them running a massively expansionary fiscal policy, right? But I mean, this was never on the cards, and this could also never work, right? So, I mean, that is not just a detail. I think one had to has to put that in.
Sure, 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 sure.
Just one more question here.
I wanted to push further on the question that this gentleman over here asked about Tobin tax and Glass-Steagall. I mean, right now, it's true that in the United States that one can have a feeling that the process is captured and it's all hopeless, but that's not the right way to think about things, and it's really important in phases like this what gets set up as the demands for when the space opens. And right now, there's a pretty serious consensus, I think, among forces for financial reform as they are organized in Washington, that what we want is three things, and they're linked, and they are the financial transactions tax, a size limit on the banks, and Glass-Steagall. And the reason for Glass-Steagall is related to deposits, but it's because as long as secondary market activity and heavy leverage is tied to the payment system, it's impossible, and to commercial credit, as it's provided day to day in the real economy, it's impossible to think about it. Well, it's not impossible. It's much, much harder to think about resolution of the kind that Tom was talking about, the Swedish model, that kind of thing, in that context. If you guys don't agree with that triangle, what do you propose?
Can I ask you a clarification quickly? So when you say Glass-Steagall, in today's world, what's that break point?
Yeah. Phil, that's a very good point. I did not mean, by the way, by Glass-Steagall, simply taking the statute book from 1935 and copying it. The basic notion is to get secondary market activity, securities, derivatives, and repo into a separate place from commercial banking. And how you would do that is a serious piece of work.
A defined set of quote-unquote higher risk activities. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I've done a bad job as chair keeping this limited, but Jamie did have his hand up.
Okay, I don't want to let that one.
Okay, we have about 10 minutes left, so I suggest that you be selective in which questions you'd like to address. Olivier, would you like to start? Phil is passing the buck to you.
Sure.
That way you're not overwhelmed by our brilliance.
True, and then you're going to be ending, then you have to step
I'm
up again.
I'm counting on you guys to fill the space.
There you go. Okay, so let me pick up some threads here. The issue of the ECB that can interfere with sovereign state affairs, I believe. I think that when you have a central bank that at the very last minute decides to cut all the fundings right prior to an election, that is definitely excessive power. And that goes against one of the themes of this conference, which is the theme of promoting democracy. This is deeply disturbing to me. This is the kind of stuff that is deeply disturbing to me. Regarding contractionary policy, another question that was more directly for me, I do not advocate the American model, I do not advocate a massive deficit for the case of Greece, piling up on additional deficits because this is a specific case. This is not the United States, as you're rightly pointing out. This is not the United States, this is the Europe with the history of Europe, et cetera. Maybe something that I skipped, I can't remember exactly which sides of my presentation that I skipped. I think what we know now, of course, this is looking with 2020 hindsight, what we know now, it would have been probably better to have a more benign neglect approach to it, that is to let the deficit as it is and then do blanket checks on the provision and guaranteeing the debt and having some kind of euro bond or having a different approach than what we know right now. I don't think that the approach of constantly going back and forth and having a very slow process in between the Troika, the different institutions, the Greek government or any other government, very slow process has helped in any way, especially that it has always resulted in always the same answer, which is austerity, austerity, austerity.
In terms of Matt's question, whether it's all driven by the money, I think no. I think I gave you a pretty more detailed taxonomy about where the power of banks come from, certainly in Europe, and it's about a whole host of issues, not just simply about the financial rewards available to policymakers who work in potentially in banks. In terms of Damon's question, I mean, I don't think if you have to expend political capital, that financial transaction tax is necessarily the thing I would expend most political capital on. I mean, if you're looking for a way to raise revenues, I think the UK tax on banks' balance sheets is a more effective way of raising revenues. And if you're looking at something which could do most to reduce risk in the banking system, I would say taking away the tax breaks for debt, and in fact, the economy as a whole, taking away the tax breaks for debt would be far more effective in terms of creating a healthier, more stable, more resilient economy than an FTT. And there's a fixation with FTT, and I think it's not, to my mind, the most effective policy.
All right, look, first of all, the financial transaction tax, I'm in favor of it, but I agree with Phil that that's, yeah, debt, getting rid of the deductibility of debt would be a good move. I would also add, though, as a dare turner, I mean, the question that was asked up there, so who makes investment decisions? It's not like you have a central director, but the case for effectively some kind of credit macroprudential regulation, especially when you get down to low interest rates, seems to me pretty compelling. Turner, in his new book, just goes on at some length, gives you a very good set of case for why, for instance, you end up almost always with too much money chasing real estate, and that the amount of debt that keeps piling up over time in the economy that is not used for any form of productive investment or even normal consumption, but just loans between institutions ending up in real estate is really something of a problem. And you know, the world's not going to collapse if you put on some macroprudential regulations. And I also think I should add that the financial transaction tax would be great for restricting stuff like high-frequency trading, which I think is simply totally parasitic. Though I haven't got time to justify that opinion. Finally, on Damon's question, no, I don't think that package is enough. And there is I'm not opposed to it, although I'm not clear what the reference to Glass-Steagall is or was there so much. But, you know, you got to do something about shadow banking. And, I mean, it's like folks, I'm in this business of breaking up the banks. I'd love to break up banks. I'm not trying to tell you you should leave large banks alone. But the notion that that fixes this system, look, let me tell you a true story, all right? I have nothing like Phil's experience, but I have a few good stories too. And one of them was I sat down with a Federal Reserve Bank strongly identified with commodities exchanges. That's all I'm gonna say. And so we were talking about a conference to sort of discuss commodities. In the course of that, commodities regulation issues, in the course of that discussion, it came out that people were essentially, it took me for a while to grasp it, but no one ever said it explicitly, but they were saying basically, now we need backstops for making loans in maybe 16 currencies. Now, I watched very closely the almost unheralded spread of the so-called swap agreements between the central banks. That is a major part of the real sort of gradual extension of the insurance, not formal, but informal insurance network that is out there. It's a really important development. Now, there have been some efforts actually to enlarge it that were turned aside. But it's out there now for, what, 6 countries, I think? I may be wrong. And, I mean, there are other people who do international stuff, but this swap agreements among central banks, and they're big, and they're pretty much permanent part of the landscape. Those folks want to enlarge that. It's like people, despite all the stuff you hear about how we don't want to bail out banks, in fact, schemes for doing this are afoot. People know it on the inside. There's, of course, zero publicity on this stuff. It's the shadow banking systems where you're not a bank at all, but you can bring down the whole system. You know, we had some of that in the late 90s, you know, where that one hedge fund nearly took the whole show down. That's not going to get fixed if you break up Citibank. So there's got to be an agenda on that. And in that sense, I think folks in Washington, if that's the true state, and I fear that it is, I'm reasonably in touch with that, they're kind of missing the boat. It's, you know, the generals in the last war comparison. That was the last crisis. We may have that again. You can pile these things on. You can always, I mean, look, this is Texas. You can go back in an endless return of the repressed, right? That you should understand from this state. But you can also do brand new things and screw everything up that way.
I wonder if I can pile a question on to Phil before he answers.
Sure.
It's closely connected to what Tom was just saying, but one of the interesting features of the crisis in 2008 was how many days was it before AIG collapsed that the federal authorities knew that it held all of the exposure on credit default swaps and was about to bring the system down?
They knew before it collapsed.
What?
They knew before.
But not very much.
By how many days?
In the suit that was filed, that one by, what's his name, who used to own AIG?
Greenberg.
Yeah, there is clearly some evidence that people were talking in August about that.
Yeah, but I think that's quite remarkable. I mean, it's only a month before Lehman collapses
right.
that the Fed says we better get a handle on all their derivative counterparties, and they were afraid to do it because they were afraid if they explicitly said we're going to look at Lehman's derivative counterparties, it would set off a panic that Lehman was in trouble, as if no one apparently knew that.
Yep.
AIG was a matter of, it was a pretty short window, pretty striking the extent to which they did not know.
So the question I would have
but
is...
remember with CDS, none of that was, the whole thing about non-regulation is you don't get reporting, therefore you don't have information.
Yeah, indeed. And so we now have a situation in which quantitative easing has been feeding a lot of activity for a long time. It could come to an end at some time in the foreseeable future. And the question would be, do we really know where the exposures are at this stage for to a different interest rate climate or to, let's say, financial problems elsewhere in the world?
That's a good question, and I'm not central enough or day-to-day enough to know the answer to that, Jamie.
Do we have any confidence that the people who are central enough have better information than we have?
I would approach it with some skepticism.
Yeah, the BIS report on the currency mismatch out about a month is pretty, Haishan Shin and the other guy who co-authored that is real clear about the lack of knowledge on that, especially against a currency mismatch story where you've got folks doing transactions across borders and now they, who owes who dollars is something of a large mystery.
Well, and I think it was pretty clear even a year ago or maybe a little while ago when people were concerned about exposure to European debt that they didn't have a very good sense of what the American institutions' exposures were. Yeah. Just quickly, I agree with something Tom said about macroprudential kind of oversight of credit allocation. You know, some people say, well, to wit, we had very cheap money, and therefore there was going to be a bubble and a crisis. I'm not sure that needs to be the result. It could also be cheap money means available capital for important works for society, and there was no compass on that. So I agree with him on that. In terms of, you know, Damon, my sense is that the financial transaction tax has some heat behind it, and therefore it is a reasonable revenue source. I'm not sure in and of itself it's, you know, a significant changer of risk allocation. And I think we already talked, by my question, I kind of answered the Glass-Steagall, which is let's define which activities don't belong there. I do want to say something to which Tom said about shadow banking. Remember that some of the moving and leading actors, not the sole actors in the 2008 crisis, were the investment banks that were quote-unquote shadow banking institutions. They had a regulator, but it was bullshit. Excuse the technical term. They had a regulator because the EU said to do business in Europe, you have to have a regulator. And they said, okay, who can we get as a regulator? We're not going to go to the comptroller of the currency because they seem to have some capability. We won't even go to the Office of Thrift Supervision, because maybe they might be too tough. Let's go to the SEC that has no history ever of doing prudential regulation over a significant investment, you know, financial, and that's who we're going to get. So they had a regulator, had no capacity to oversee those banks and didn't have the culture, didn't have the capacity.
Okay, I'm afraid on that note we're out of time, but I want to thank the panel for a very interesting discussion.
That was great.
Yeah, that was good. We did not disgrace ourselves.